Warning. The following show is likely to switch topics faster than a Kardashian switches NBA players in bed. Caution is advised. We surveyed 100 people. Actually, no, just some dudes off the street about JB. And here are the top answers. Number one, JB, I love JB. Did I say that right? Do I still get my Chick-fil-A gift card? Number two, who? Number three, I know JB. He don't know sh**. And now he's got a f***ing podcast?
This is What the Hell Do I Know with JB.
JB, your friendly late-stage midlife husband, dad, and self-diagnosed ADHD connoisseur. This is all about candid conversation with friends, colleagues, and professionals, unpacking life's lessons and having a damn fun time doing it. And hey, sometimes we're going to veer off topic, but isn't that what makes life interesting? Let's talk about taking the good parts and leaving the bad. Because life's too short for unnecessary baggage.
This is What the Hell Do I Know with JB. And now your host, Jason Becker.
All right, we are back again, man. I mean, I was just saying how I would typically like to just start a show dry and let's just start talking, but I still like to hear the intro. It's something that kind of jazzed me up. Rhea, you were just saying that you just kind of started hearing it and thought it was kind of,
yes,
it catches,
I was gonna,
right?
Tell you, the first time you listened to it, it's hilarious. You guys are probably used to it, but it's the first time.
I giggle at it every time. I don't know why.
It's pretty funny. By the way, I'm so excited. We're back again. Another episode right at you. We've got, of course, my good friend Juice.
What's up?
What do you do? And then my good friend B Money.
Brandon's back. I like this seat. It's a good seat. I get to learn a lot every time.
That's right. And then my friend Maria, we've known each other forever. Maria Galati, we're so excited to see you.
Oh, I'm so happy to be here. This is a bucket list item of mine, to be on a podcast.
I can't believe we're the first podcast.
It's the hottest podcast in the Emerald Coast right now.
Social media queen. How in the world are you just now doing a podcast?
Oh my goodness, you're flattering me. No, this is huge. I'm so happy to be here. Thank you for having me.
Well, we're excited to have you. Yeah. And listen, all my viewers, thank you again so much for listening. You know, I continue to be amazed. Anybody wants to listen to some old guys on a mic, it's ridiculous sometimes, but we're thankful for it. You know, occasionally I get a reel or something like that that's a weird comment. And, you know, but by the way, I appreciate all your comments. So I appreciate it. I really do. But I got a weird one the other day that I don't even remember what it was, but just said, like, Trumpy, no thank you, was the comment. I thought, when did I talk about politics? Like, where was that come in play?
I'm avoiding politics.
What do you mean? Whatever. I'm not even sure what it meant. But I appreciate everybody that's watching. We even have people that watch in Russia.
All right.
And even Turkey. So Privat would be hello. And
right.
Privat.
Wow.
Privat.
Okay. Did
das Vidanya.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then Merhaba, which would be Turkish for hello. So thank you so much. Absolutely.
Wow.
Right.
I'm impressed.
All right. So Marie and I made this drink earlier. You'll catch this on a reel. We'll drop the recipe on a reel, and you'll get to see this. But here's our gin drink of the day. And so,
delicious.
Yeah,
refreshing.
Absolutely. So cheers, everyone.
Cheers.
As always, drink only if you are 21 and older, and of course, drink responsibly.
All right, let's see how this is. I'm not a fan of gin or cucumbers.
You're in for an awakening.
What's funny? Oh, and rosemary too. Let's see if you can swallow that one down, huh? You might be switching. You know, and what's weird is I sat down and I thought to myself, is there a drink that would totally stump Juice?
This is it.
And this is where I came.
You got me.
Wow.
I'm interested. What do you think the over-under is that he finishes this anyway?
Oh, I'm going to drink it.
It's
going to get drunk, dude. You ever tell them ordered the wrong drink at a bar? I'm like, I'll just drink it, you know, and then...
That's
tough through it.
Well, so our show sponsor today is Galati Yachts. GalatiYachts.com. Galati Yacht Sales has one simple philosophy: always do right by the customer. These aren't just words for us, but are part of our DNA. It's a philosophy we've believed in from the very beginning, when in 1970, Michael Galati Sr. rebuilt a hurricane-damaged marina on Anna Maria, Florida. near Tampa Bay. And it's been there ever since. 50 years, 15 locations, and three generations later. It's a philosophy that starts at the top and runs right down to every one of our team members, regardless of their job title. The Gulati team is behind you before, during, and after the sale. That's why almost two-thirds of our team members are dedicated to after the sale service. The Gulatis are a boating family, and like you, enjoy boating and its many pleasures. When you purchase a yacht from Gulati Yacht Sales, you become part of our boating family, and as family, we'll always be there for you.
Wow, that's great.
That AI did so not write good. That, too.
AI did not write that. AI did not write
that. Funny. Yeah, that's we had so that great. Conversation a couple pods back with the teacher.
Oh, we did.
About
we
her
did.
Ballot in high school now. Everybody's writing their stuff.
For AI. She has to have AI checkers.
Yes, oh,
she
I'm has. Sure they have apps for that now, too. Mm-hmm. That's crazy.
My son in school at Tampa, his professors, like before they turned in a paper one semester, they told them all, listen, if you wrote this with AI, you need to just come clean now because we're going to catch you. You know, my son went up to his professor. He's like, well, I didn't use AI, but I used like a spell check, like grammar check sort of thing. Yeah. Like, that's not what we're talking about.
That's very different from the plagiarism check they did back in college.
That's not what we're talking about.
Oh, my papers were lit up red everywhere, dude, when I use those grammar checks.
But I am excited. I am excited that we have the one and the only Maria Gulati Hill. I mean, I'm so that's excited awesome, to have you on the show today. It's amazing.
I'm one of many. Absolutely. We're a huge Italian family. We're all invested in the company in different ways, and I'm happy to be here.
Yeah. No, I'm so glad to have you. I mean, we've known each other for a little while. We've seen each other around town. My family's been buying boats from Gulati's forever. In fact, I ran into you and your husband at the ECBC just recently. And we talked about that the last pod. And we were saying, and for the folks at home, and if you didn't hear it the last time, the Emerald Coast Billfish Classic, it's one of the top fishing tournaments around.
Blue Marlin Classic.
Right? Blue Marlin.
Yeah. It's the biggest purse in the Gulf of Mexico normally.
Biggest purse. Okay.
Yeah, Emerald Coast Blue Marlin Classic.
Blue Marlin. I always want to say Billfish, but it's Blue Marlin.
So the Billfish is this, or they got the Bay Point Billfish is this weekend in Panama City.
Oh, that's in Panama City.
Through fishing as we speak that way.
Yeah. Oh, your husband's there. Right, right. You were just there like yesterday. Yes. I think I saw you're all over the place.
Well, they had a shotgun today, right?
Yes, they did. And I would have been there if it wasn't pouring rain. I was like, I don't know how much content I can get with the rain, but it still was a cool sight to see 89 boats kicking off at the same time. Full throttle. That is.
What does that purse get up to on that one?
Good question. I don't know. Every
what
tournament
does the purse get up to on the Emerald Coast?
Last year it got to $1.8 million.
$1.8 million.
Yeah, last year.
The winner.
Well, it's the total purse. The total purse.
What do you think's the top prize?
So ECBC, their record winning. Sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, no,
it just takes time. Our customer, our Viking customer.
Okay.
He won. It was the largest sum to ever be won in history, and it was over $500,000.
$500,000.
Yes.
Was that this last one?
That was two years ago.
Yeah, a couple years ago.
$500,000 for the fish. Yeah.
That's a cool story, too, because we got that boat to him fresh out of the factory just in time for that tournament. And we didn't know if it was going to make it in time.
Right.
He gets the boat, goes out fishing, wins the largest
purse ever. Yeah.
Wow. That's a good luck boat.
Which helps to make some fuel payments there.
It definitely covers the cost there.
Yeah.
That is crazy. That's awesome. Well, now we're going to go to our section of new news. So does anybody have any new news they want to share with our audience at large? I'll share some with you. I'm headed to Greece. I'm going to go to Greece. We're going to do a little cruise around and see Greece a little bit. And then we're going to go over to Florence for a few days. And then into Italy there. Well, Florence is in Italy, but we're going to go to Rome, I should say. And we're going to spend a week in Rome. We're staying at the same villa that Valentino lived in at the end of his life. So I'm really excited about this. I think that's kind of the part of my trip. And it's, you know, right in the heart of Rome. And for me, I love Rome because it's like the second birthplace of Christianity. So there's all these.
It's a lot of history.
History there. There's catacombs. Just so much. I mean, just so many things to see. There's St. Paul's outside the walls. People don't realize it, but it's like as big as the Vatican, but it's just outside of Rome. And nobody's there.
Wow.
I mean, it's amazing. So I'm really looking forward to it. And by the way, by the time this airs, I'll be back. So don't even try if you're thinking that I'm giving away, I'm going out of town. So,
oh, me and Brandon know that you're going out of town.
I might be house sitting for a while. Yeah.
Well, y'all are welcome to use the pool anytime. Yeah.
Right. Okay. No, you're going to regret
anybody
that.
Anybody else have any new news that they want to share?
I get just living a great life. Blessed. Yeah. We live down here and we get to see family and we got some friends in town right now. And
oh, do you?
Yeah.
Who's in town?
A good buddy of mine, Rob Workman. They're just always been good friends of ours.
Shout out, Rob.
Took a break with his son to come down and visit. So
good.
Just a good guy. I met him at a concert, and then
three years later,
I met him driving through the neighborhood, and we became neighbors.
I mean, everybody knows the story how I met Brandon.
Yeah, I was about to say this. How sounds like
this is how he met me. I was All right, if you saw the little technical difficulties, we'll see if our editor cuts it out again. Again, we're just a little old $10
podcast.
We
can't keep saying this every episode.
Hey, I'm gonna have a T-shirt made that I'm just a $10 podcast.
Yeah. Oh man,
as the mic is slowly dropping.
Slowly dropping.
I'm like going with it down.
That's so great.
Oh, man. Yeah, just don't breathe or talk into the mic.
Brandon, you meet people. Brandon and I met when Danielle and I were trying to figure out if we were going to move down here, and we were on the beach and hanging out. I didn't know, you know, and we tried to pick a down spot in the season, which there aren't many down here
anymore.
But there used to be, like, right after spring break, right before, you know, when kids are graduating. And there still is a little moment, but that felt like it was like a month back then. And so we were, okay, let's see if we can find people our same age and stage in life. And at any rate, I did what people do when they go into the ocean. And because, you know, I had had a few drinks, I needed to go into the ocean and I needed to relieve myself. And here comes Brandon swimming right into me.
And I do what I do. I go talk to people in the ocean.
Hey, man.
I'm like a Labrador puppy. I got to talk to you now.
I love it.
That was like 9 years ago. Yeah. It's insane. No doubt.
What a fun ride, though.
Yeah, no, good ride. A lot of travel, a lot of trips together. You've been on the boat when we had the big boat. You've been on all my boats, so yeah.
Y'all just saw Justin Timberlake together.
We just saw Justin Timberlake.
Did y'all hold hands all the time?
Well, we did it before he got his DWI.
Yeah, that's some new news right there. Yeah.
Hey, that was an amazing concert.
Did you guys hear about that when he said this is going to ruin the tour? Did you?
Oh, yes.
I couldn't help but laugh at that one.
Oh, man.
Oh, JT.
I love his music, but that was a tough one. You can't be drinking and driving.
No.
Yeah, we say that every time. You know that.
You're better than that, JT.
That's
right. Yeah, of all people, you know.
Of all people.
For real.
Of all people. Well, listen, we're going to jump right into it's time to play What the Hell Do I Know, which I'm going to give you a rapid set of questions, rapid succession, 7 questions. I'm going to put the clock on, and here we go. All right. So, what is your favorite restaurant down here?
Oh, that's a really tough one. Aja 38.
Oh, yeah, okay. That's over in the beach. Yeah.
Sushi and sake.
Sushi and sake. Okay. Your favorite vacation spot?
Probably Greece, which is funny you're going there. Yes.
Hey, we need to talk after this.
Okay.
Do you have a favorite slogan or saying that you like to go to?
Ooh, it changes a lot.
You can pass.
I try not to be repetitive. Pass.
Okay. People around boating have some crazy names like Cappy or whatever. What is one of the better names you've heard for somebody? Good names for somebody.
Spanky.
Spanky. Spanky. Yes. Spanky's been with us forever. Yes. Great.
Shout out, Spanky. Yeah, absolutely. What is the largest vessel that you have captained or operated?
That I've operated?
Yeah.
Probably 60 foot.
60 foot. Do you hear that?
I docked it myself.
Yes.
With the baby strapped to me.
Wow.
We can clip that.
That is awesome.
Talk about female power right there.
We got to drop that in. Okay, so how many Galates are there in the world?
Oh, my gosh. Well, we hail from Italy, so I don't know who's over there.
Okay.
But we've got about, like, 45 family members extended. I have 12 cousins, aunts, uncles, and we're all in the business.
And you're all in the business.
Yeah.
One big happy family.
Yes, one big happy family.
That's awesome. What is the favorite thing you like that your mother cooks?
Ooh, everything. Oh, her meatball tortellini soup.
Oh, yes. Very nice.
That sounds good.
That does sound good.
You might need that recipe.
That sounds really good. Well, great job.
You did nice work. Yeah. Nice work.
Yeah, great job. Great.
Easy peasy.
What was the one you passed on?
A slogan. I don't have a slogan.
That's okay.
I try not to be repetitive. Being on camera, you don't want to say the same things all the time. So I don't have anything.
For sure. So, Maria, here's your chance. I'd like to hear maybe like a 2 minute, 30 second, maybe 2 minutes is probably too long.
But I'd say like 30 seconds. 30 minutes. 30 minutes. More
just
of a novel
like a
form.
Helicopter view about you and Galati Yacht Sales and what you're doing.
Oh, goodness. Okay. So, Galati's is a really cool, like, American dream story. Mm-hmm. You know, like, that story alone could kind of go on a little too long. But pretty much, my grandfather found this hurricane devastated marina in Anna Maria Island, Florida. And he was drawn to it really because my grandmother's name is Anna Maria, and he's always loved boating, always loved ships. So he moved his entire family there. My dad, 8 years old, the oldest of five, the youngest in a freaking car seat.
Right.
And they just take a whim and just move out of New York and go try to find a better lives for themselves. And they're all running this marina together. They're catching bait. They're selling fuel on the dock. They're cleaning up this hurricane devastation. And they just kind of fell in love with this entire process of working together as a team. Mm-hmm. And the boating industry. And we came from service. So that's why we always talk about that's what makes us different. Because when you buy a boat, you know, not to veer off, but when you buy a boat, you usually don't get that service after the sale. Like, it's a one and done type of process.
Yep.
And not to call anybody out, of course, but that's just kind of how it is. And we said, you know, that's not what we want to do. We want to, it's more important after the sale.
That's
we want to make sure, you know, that family trip is booked for a week from now. You're going to get out there and you're going to go do that. And we're going to do everything in our power to make sure that happens.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, in fact, it's, you know, our family's been buying Galati boats for decades. We've been buying
and
boats
thank you
with
for
Galati.
That. And I loved hearing when we were talking about me coming on the podcast, you had said something that really struck me. You said, my family has never been closer than when we were on our boat. And that's why we do what we do.
100%.
And that's why I'm making the content I do, because I want people to feel that and be drawn to that.
Hey, you know, we had a nice, our last boat we had with you guys was a 63 Prestige. And so I don't know how many square feet it is, but, you know, the salon, you know, when you go from your home into essentially a floating RV, you have to learn to love people really well.
So
I always told my family I was really sorry for whatever I said when we were docked. I got radios for us just because I got tired of yelling at my son, you know. And
that's how you test a couple, how you test a family dynamic.
What was funny, I love my son, so he's going to hate me telling this story, but when he was younger and he would have like the bow of the boat, my wife might have the aft and my daughters, you know, might be right at the center. And I would, you know, in ropes while we're docking, and I always say, you know, something to Jackson, I need you to hurry. I need you to go ahead and run on up there. And it seemed like when I said run, that's when he would start, like, slow walking. It was like, don't you tell me what to do. And I'm like, dude, I really need you to move right now.
This is important. So,
but, you know, we really did have some great closeness because you put five people in the water and you go to places. And so when you're there, you're washing the boat together, you're getting off together, and, you know, then you go and eat dinner together. And it's just so much closeness about it. It's just so much fun. There's so, I mean, just a lot of, some of my favorite memories are just those memories on the water. And so, I'm so thankful for that time, and it was a lot of fun. I look forward to doing it again. Now they're scattered every different which way, so it's a little harder in this season, but, you know, maybe we'll get back there with some of the younger kids when they come along, you know, in a long, long time from now. But, you know, I think when I counted it, Maria, we did like 10 to 12 transactions that we've done through my father-in-law all the way up into, you know, my last boat that I did. I think it's been 10 or 12 transactions. My father-in-law started with like a little 42 cruiser and then 65 Marquis. And
well, you can have a lot of hobbies, but boating is one for the entire family.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of those things that are really just going to push you together, like you said.
Yeah.
And I just love hearing that story because that's really what it's all about. We just actually did a family trip to the BVIs and boated around the islands. And there's nothing like, my daughters came back. I have a 2 and a 4-year-old and they came back from that trip so bonded, closer than ever. And I was like, what is a little different? I'm like, that trip.
Because they're sleeping in a little bitty bedroom together.
Yeah. They were on that boat together for a week and a half, and they came back and they were just like this. And I said, that's what boating does right there.
Yeah, no doubt.
And that would be fun.
It's a lot of fun. Now, when I was going to ask you, you said you went on your family, so it was immediate family, not the 48 other jabronis.
Yes, exactly. we used to go together until the boats weren't big enough anymore. So.
Talk about a tie up there. You're like your own crab island when you get Galati's together.
Oh, heck yes. I know. We have family reunions every Christmas, Thanksgiving, my non's birthday. We have to now find bigger and bigger venues to host all of us.
Funny thing, my father-in-law, when he bought the 65 Marquis, we took it over to, of course, a fun thing to do, and I'm not unleashing any secret deal here, but if you own a boat in this, especially if you're in this Emerald Coast, right, where we are, and you've got an overnight boat, a fun thing to do is to take it to Orange Beach. I mean, it's almost like a, so a rite of passage.
I'm going there in 3 days, actually. Yes.
So I'll see you there.
Yeah.
Because you're going to see Bert.
Oh, perfect. My gosh. We'll I'm hosting. There. That's part of my job on the side is I host events for our customers.
Well, we'll come by and say hey.
Okay, great. We're doing a 4th of July customer trip. So that's hosting. Awesome. We're doing a wine pairing dinner at Bellagio.
Yeah,
and we're going to the Oasis Pool. So I'm excited. Orange Beach is such a great place.
It's such a great spot. Yeah. And it's a great marina for boaters to go over there.
Shout out to the wharf.
Absolutely. They just do a great job there. But we pulled up in his 65 Marquis, went and saw Kenny Chesney. And when we got there, I don't know if you guys had just opened an office there. Or maybe
we've had it there for a while, actually.
You have?
Yeah.
This would have been, you know, over a decade ago.
Oh, okay.
So he got off the boat, and a bunch of the guys there were like, well, are you Mr. Galati? And he has an Italian look, but they thought he was Mr. Galati. He's like, no, I'm not. But I was like, you should have said you were. You might have got a little discount or something. So you gave us a little bit of the story of the family from New York back in the 70s, right?
Yes, 1970 was when we started. So yeah. I'm now the third generation in our family
third
business.
Generation
yes.
of family business.
And they didn't get the opportunity to go to college because they were, you know, from eight years old starting this family
Focus.
Business. So they encouraged all of us. They're like, please go and do what we couldn't do and study.
Absolutely.
So I went to Florida State, was in the advertising program, and it was incredible. It was like this own mini marketing firm, and we actually rebranded real clients. And I would give anything
Very
for
nice.
That experience. But funny thing is, we didn't study social media. I'm going to show my age here. But that was just not a way of, that was just a personal thing
just
at the time.
Started,
it
right?
wasn't a business thing.
Right.
So it's funny now that I've become kind of like the social media, you know, guru of sorts from learning.
Well, you're great at it.
Oh,
yeah,
no,
you're
thank
great
you.
At it.
Guru is the right word.
Yeah.
Well, that's what my friend called me. So I was like, I'm going to just use that one because I don't know what else to say. But it's just funny how that's now it's probably a huge portion of a career or
it's the new retail store.
It is, and even if you were probably studying marketing at Florida State, now I'm sure there's social media
courses
and classes, and that is just so cool to me how it changes.
If there's not a social media degree now, there's got to be coming in the
digital marketing. I think is probably what they have to
call it,
if I had to guess. But so cool.
They just needed to make it sound fancy.
Yeah,
they do.
But by the way, what do you guys name your Galati boats when you guys will have a boat? And you might put in a fishing tournament, or you might...
Team Galati,
yes. Right? Okay. Because today I just saw the center console guy, which I was talking to you the other day about him, how I love that guy. Follow theirs. It's like, I think it's just center console.
He's center consoles only.
Center consoles
yes,
only.
Alan, he's my buddy. Yeah.
I mean, by the way, if you like boating and maybe you're looking
follow
at something
him.
A little small, you should absolutely follow center consoles only. It's so good. I follow him. I love seeing all
he
the new things.
He does a great job.
He does a really
he's
good job.
He's actually one of the people that inspired me, shout out Alan, to get out there and put a face to a brand.
Yeah.
And, you know, it just, we were selling boats and just showing the boats. And it was my little brother who's, I say little, but he's, you know, just a year younger than me.
Yeah.
And
well,
he goes,
little.
Yeah, you know, you have to put this face to a brand and it becomes more personal. And that's really something that also is kind of being studied at the moment. And it is working for businesses to have this like personal touch and not just sell online and really sell the experience, sell the lifestyle. Mm-hmm. So I finally took the leap. It was terrifying.
Sure
but
it was.
He was
sure
one of the people that inspired me as well as others. And I just put myself out there and it was absolutely terrifying.
Yeah.
Because you're like, what are people going to do? Are they going to rip me apart? Are they going to...
Well,
you know,
you're always going to have naysayers.
The bigger you get, that's what I've told myself too, is once Galati's account got very large, you're always naturally going to have some negativity. And that means you've made it.
That's right.
That means
that's
you've
right.
made it. And
no,
you have
hey,
to look
hey,
at it that
I
way.
I need the first... Hey, maybe that no Trumpy one was a troll. That might have been
you
my
had,
first troll.
Having trolls is great because it just means you're reaching a broader network. You're reaching other sides of the internet
for everybody,
and that means you're growing. So
that's a positive 100%. That's so good. But
jealousy.
You know, he just posted something I think today talking about like a boat naming contest or boat names getting
only fins.
So cool. Only fins. Yes, he said only. Yeah. Have there any other boat names that you guys have heard that are kind of like out there?
There's
I couldn't talk
you
about it.
Yeah, I was about to say
they're always the worst ones, right?
It's always because that's the ones that stick.
Well, Glassy Hooker is
well,
a good one.
Yeah, that one's here. That's
so funny.
I like the one, this was years ago, but a couple pharmacists have a boat together and it's called Drug Money.
Oh, interesting.
Well, the boat that won the Blue Marlin Classic this week was called Just a Tip.
Yes, that's the one. I think the funniest ones are when they tie it to their profession in some way.
That's
the best. I love it.
We had the one that was Let's Talk Trash. That was Dave's old boat, you know, from the sanitation company, Let's Talk Trash.
And he was a sanitation company. So cool.
He tied it right in. Yeah. He even had the Oscar. I had to find like our Oscar the Grouch guy and a garbage guy, like animation, and put it on there.
You should get that as a tattoo somewhere, like an Oscar.
I don't know that I'm going that. You know what's so funny?
A picture of it.
Here's what's funny is we would sometimes, like, if at a customer, typically when we had our sanitation, you know, I was second generation garbage hauler. And we would have put cans, garbage cans out, you know, 95-gallon cans. We'd put them out at customers' homes, but we owned the cans. That was our asset. Now, typically when somebody moved, we left the can. However, occasionally you just had to go and kind of repo a garbage can. You know, you weren't getting anywhere. Goodness, you had to go and do it, and so you had to go get a garbage can and bring it back and condition or whatever. But I remember we had a guy go to this guy's house, you know, and our guy to pick up cans. And he wouldn't do it that often, but, you know, every week you'd have a few that just – the house wasn't turning, and it's like, we need to get that asset, those assets back. So you have 30 or 40 cans you might have to pick up in a week. At any rate, he went to a guy's house, and we couldn't believe it. We had to send a manager back with him. The guy was like, "You're not taking my can." And we said, "Well, why not?" And so he pulled his shirt up, and he had an Oscar the Grouch tattoo on his whole chest and stomach, colored. And so we were like, "Yeah, you can keep the can."
What in the world?
That's hilarious.
God, so, I wish I had iPhones back then to get a picture of that crap.
Yeah. That would have been great. Yeah, no iPhone. Yeah, no.
Well, we know the address. I mean, maybe he's still there.
No, it's like, I'm not going to tell you. It's right up there. It's probably been bulldozed over. But Maria, you are very, very influential in the boating verse. I mean, you were just named. You're just awarded the 40 under 40 in the boating industry.
That's
a huge honor.
Thank you so much.
Your reels and social media, they have absolutely blown up. I mean, how did you, I mean, you kind of talked a little bit about finding your niche, but I mean, your brother came to call, tells you, come on, let's do this. I mean, what is the first step you started taking? I mean, how did the reels look then compared to now?
Yeah, I know. They really transformed as I got more confident, I think, because you're terrified at first and you're wondering, oh, what is everyone going to think? Like, this is how
even while you're doing it, right? People are watching me. I look silly.
Oh, that's even the worst part. Like, the ones that got really popular, like the interviews, I had to approach them. Mm. They didn't even know me, and I had to just walk up with a camera behind me and be like, hey, can I interview you and ask you these questions? And it was all about approaching them the right way, making sure they were comfortable with that. And it's like the talking about fishing superstitions that I walked around last ACBC tournament and asking them their lucky fishing songs or at the, you know, and then it kind of rolled into the Informa Boat Shows, which runs Miami, Fort Lauderdale, St. Pete. They reached out to me and were like, we'd love to work with you and make videos and you interview, you know. So
awesome.
Then I started interviewing like passerby, you know, show attendees, asking where they're from, what kind of boat they're shopping for. And really, it's just like this. I do love talking to people, so I just kind of have to forget the camera's there. That's really what it is.
That's right.
And I think the worst part of putting yourself out there and like just going for it is you could tend to get really scripted on accident.
Mm.
And that's the thing that I had to make sure I pulled away from, because at the beginning I was doing that on accident. And I said, you know what? I really want people to get to know me, it be more personal. So I just went off script.
Do you, when you have a concept and you're coming up with a concept, do you like to, I mean, do you concept it out? Like, here's the idea I'm doing, but then you're not scripting it, right? So is that where you're at, or are you just off the fly?
No, so it's funny because it's a little bit of half and half.
Okay.
Like, we just had a video that's going viral that I just posted from the ECBC tournament last week, and that was totally off the fly. I was just walking the docks to go get a picture at the end of the pier, and someone from the boat recognized me. Our customers, don't blink. They're amazing. Yeah. I didn't know them at all.
Another great
name. Maria from the videos, come aboard. We want to show you
that's
something
awesome.
Cool on our boat.
You're talking about the drink,
the vodka dispensary thing.
I need to add that just to my bar.
Yeah, right. Right? So cool. And that was just off the fly.
Amazing.
And that wasn't even something like, it just, I saw it out the corner of my eye and I said, can I film this? This is so cool. So some of it's off the fly. Others, I spend so much, a ridiculous amount of time preparing for. One of those being my full walkthroughs on yachts. When I have to go through all the key features, because I'm not a salesman. I'm not a broker.
Right.
But because I've been in the industry long enough, I know a lot of it. So I have to just kind of memorize these types of things. And that's probably my hardest videos that I put a lot of preparation into, because I don't want to sound like an idiot. I don't want to mess up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't want to say the wrong term, you know. Yeah. And luckily, you know, I am new to the technical mechanical side of things, electronics. Like, that's all new world for me. So I'm definitely putting myself out there and making sure. I always send it to a broker too, or my cousin. Like with Nick Carm, my brother. Sure. I'm like, hey, watch this. Like, did I say anything stupid? Did I mess up? Because you never know. You like, never.
By the way, the brokers in Galata Yacht Sales must love you, because you've got to be sending them just the greatest questions and people calling up. I want that in my boat, or I want to do this, or can you find me this? I mean, by the way, I should shout out right now to my yacht broker, Eric Sass, who is with Galata Yachts. But yeah, so back to it again. We had a little technical difficulties. Again, we might be a $5 podcast after today.
I'm going to leave.
But
I'm going to leave.
Juice is going to be not worth the squeeze.
I got to plug my camera in.
Apparently. Yeah, we need to plug it in for sure. Are you shooting in like 60K these days, or what are we doing?
I'm with the 30.
But back to the show, I do want to give a shout out to my yacht broker, who is with Galata Yachts and has been my broker forever, because if I didn't, he'd probably be like, why didn't you mention me in the Galata Yachts podcast? Yeah. But no, honestly, Eric Sass, I love you. You've been great. And one of the things that Eric says, which is what you pointed out, is the service size. He said this every time I bought a boat, anytime my brother-in-law's bought a boat, anytime my father-in-law bought a boat, is we're not just here today. We're here for all the other days.
Absolutely.
You know, and by the way, hats off to you guys. I mean, I was in, we were on the Prestige, and I lost a port side engine. Yeah, port side engine. We had a drive shaft come off the engine on the flywheel that went to the pod and turned the pod around. I guess the manufacturer put in the wrong screws, and it just sheared off and dropped. And I started getting alarmed. I didn't know what to do. I called Galata with Sean. Mm-hmm. So called Sean. He was on the phone with me right away. He walked me through several different things. And I mean, I'm between Miami and like Key West.
Yeah.
And we end up determining I need to go back to Miami. But within 2 or 3 days, Volvo was there and fixed the whole thing. Everything was under warranty. And I was back on my way. But they really were. Like, I didn't worry about anything. Yeah. I didn't have to make a bunch of phone calls. I didn't have to track anybody down. And it's, it's not anybody's fault. Things happen.
Yeah.
You know, especially with that many moving parts on the water. You know, it can happen, but they took care of it, and fortunately, it was all under warranty, because it was a hefty bill, I happened to see.
Yeah.
But that would have been on the Volvo, folks. But it worked out great, and right back up, and like I said, it only cost us, I think, 2 days or 3 days.
Yeah.
Hey,
stuck in Miami.
It's another basketball
it's
game or something.
It's an adventure.
Yeah, it was great. But I did want to give a shout out to Eric. Like I said, I was a second generation garbage hauler. And so I always felt a little bit of pressure doing what I was doing, being second generation. Yeah. And people would look at me, and not only that, but I was the son-in-law. Yeah. So people would be like, oh, he's only here because he married in. He's only here because he did those things. And so, I always felt like I needed to prove myself. And ultimately, I think I did, although there are people that, probably still naysayers. But I mean, how do you keep your foot? Because I know, being third generation, because the saying, right? First generation makes it, second generation keeps it, third generation loses it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they say. You guys are staying focused. Mm-hmm. And how do you stay focused?
Well, that's a really good question. But I think what it is just the passion that, like, we bleed like this. We care so much, And also, I do think, like you said, the old guard, that's really coming from the second generation, like, trusting the changes. Like, we are currently in this time going through a social media revolution.
100%.
Like, there was the Industrial Revolution.
Right.
And we're in the social media revolution. All these jobs are being formed. And it was just, and when you mentioned, like, the brokers and social media, I've been working for the company in the marketing team for about 8 years since I graduated college. And basically, it went from social media being a super small portion of my job. I used to design all the ads, email blasts, print ads, website ads, and just design. And social media was just something I did on the back burner. And that slowly transitioned into being a critical part of the gig.
It's a massive part. And in fact, it should be a massive part of everybody's business.
It really should be, and it's
sure.
not. And
sure.
it's not always. And I think people are starting to wake up and yeah. realize, okay, we need this to be the frontier, you know, and because it does drive a lot. Actually, did you know last year, I believe the stat is correct, and I hope it is, but I believed last year was the first year that Instagram surpassed Google in searches.
Wow, no
yeah.
way.
And that just shows you that that's where people are leaning to. That's where people are going.
Wow. Yep.
And it's just interesting. So they've let me put in basically what they told me is, you know, like we know you have it. Mm-hmm. we want to push you all the way. And at first I was kind of bored in social media because it was just literally posting a profile shot of a boat and a caption and the price. And I was so bored. Social media at that time, 2 years ago, was my least favorite part of my job, which is hilarious because yeah, now it's nice. Like my entire career. Mm-hmm. It just 2 years ago. And they... Basically, what I did is I wrote up this entire proposal and presented it to them, to the upper management, yep. which is family members and non-family members.
Sure.
And
which, by the way, that's really cool that your family does that. In other words, they're not getting like bogged down in the theory that only Gulati understands Gulati, right?
Yeah.
And so having a little bit different perspectives
yes.
of people outside of it,
absolutely,
you know, that can help to breathe, you know, because you can get. You can get blind spots in
yeah,
business.
Yeah, absolutely.
You
My
really
boss,
can.
She's a boss.
Yeah,
Mary
that's
Strauss.
Awesome.
She's
that's awesome.
Incredible. I admire her so much. And she and I like her perspective because she's a non-Gulati. And mm-hmm. we need to have that. We need to have that
yeah.
direction as the head of marketing.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
sure.
she basically had this faith in me. And I was a little skeptical of my own self.
Sure.
And I basically presented to her and my Uncle Carmine, and he's the head of sales,
yeah.
and said, you know, I wrote up, this is where I want to take social media. If,
yep.
if I'm going to be just social media, this is where I want it to grow to
yeah.
for me to enjoy and love my job
yep.
and for it to benefit the company. This is what will make
but
me happy. And
both,
this is
right?
what, yeah, that's the beautiful part of it. Mm-hmm. It's like, I'm having a great time. I'm enjoying this. I'm loving my job, but we're seeing this increase in brand awareness, this increase
Absolutely.
In sales and this increase in conversation about
yeah.
us. And
you
that
were
in
telling
turn,
me downstairs that Gulati's social media following is the number one in social media following in the world in the boating industry.
I've been looking for more.
You're looking
but
for somebody to take it.
Yeah,
you're looking
That's
for some
cool.
of the brokerage to take
I'm
it.
I'm looking for somebody with more followers, but at the moment we're
number
one. And then
people over in Monaco don't know what they're
That's
doing
fine.
In Monaco.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
The
ACDC
videos.
Throw down
well,
to Florida.
I need to go look at Monaco. Yeah,
Palma Mallorca, step up your game.
I will challenge you. If you have more,
Heck
please
yes.
drop the comments. I want to know.
100%.
I haven't found
yeah.
you yet then.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that says something right there.
It sounds like the third generation is going to do
yes,
better than the
exactly.
last generation.
Well, that's what you want.
Yes.
Yeah. That's
yes,
what you want.
Exactly.
Right.
And I thank them so much for trusting us. And this is what I'm doing is really push us out of our comfort
sure.
zone. You know, a lot of the
sure.
creative ideas are out there and fun and different.
Mm-hmm.
And to let me kind of take that and ride with it is something that I did have to earn as
yeah,
like a normal
sure.
employee, like take out the Gulati part too.
Right.
And because that's how they treat us too. Like we're normal, you know, we're not. No special treatment here.
Mm-hmm.
And we had to work our way to it. And I just really appreciate that because that's those funny ideas and those silly trends. At first you're like, what is this? And then it's blowing up 10 million hits and then they understand, okay.
But you're nonstop too. I mean, here you are, you're on this, you know, $5, $10 podcast right here talking to us about social media.
$3.50
by the
time
we're done. This has been the highlight of my week.
$3.50 podcast. But you know, but you're here you are and I mean, it's 7:30, 8 o'clock at night on a weeknight, and you're over here shooting this podcast because the only time we could really fit it
kids
in.
Kids are at the house by themselves running around.
Well, you know, they just throw up a few crackers out there.
Joe Gulati is babysitting them right now as we speak, actually.
Joe
yeah.
Gulati. Joe got him.
That's so good.
Joe B-Paw, as I call him.
That's so awesome.
That's great.
By the way, man, I love your dad, too. He's so great. When we were looking at our bigger boat,
he
and we were
cool.
going up, he was the one that like told Eric, he's like, hey, I know the Beckers. You got to tell him to look at this boat because it's the right one for him. And so we flew down to Fort Myers just to take a look at the boat her dad suggested us to go and see on his suggestion. So it really is family, though. That's
yeah.
the thing. That you get that no matter how big you as continue to grow, family continues to come out. I mean, and by the way, the boating world is dominated by men. And you were talking about having to go up to men. I mean, you've probably had to walk up to some salty captains that are like, I don't want to give you no interview.
Oh, 1,000 times, yeah. Right?
I mean, and traditionally it's men. Sales in large part are by men. I mean, you know, but the times, they be changing.
Yeah.
You know, and Galati, by the way, has always leaned into family. And I can even remember a decade ago where they used to have the boating classes for women.
Yeah.
To come, you know, right here.
Ladies
in Destin,
at the helm.
Ladies
yes.
at the helm.
Oh, cool. We still do those.
You're still doing it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you guys have been above, before the trend, you know, well before.
Yeah,
that,
my mom
you know,
started that 100%. In the 80s.
That's great. That's amazing.
I love it.
Yeah. That's amazing. So I know
teach
that
them how to dock a boat, get their captain's license.
That's good to know in case there's a medical emergency or anything, right?
Oh, yeah.
Say you are going to Keys and something happens to you, Daniel, you need to know how to do that.
100%. But, you know, they weren't just taking ladies out on just these bigger boats. Even they were doing, you know, smaller center consoles. There's different things that they can do. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, what you don't realize is what a day for a bunch of ladies to get on a center console and go to Crab Island.
Boating is for both genders.
Yeah.
It's one of the only things, yes. you know, 100%. Like one of the very few things that both men and women enjoy equally.
Yes.
And that's really cool. And that does surprise me that there's not as much women in the industry because why not? You know,
100%.
It's
do you feel it changing?
I do.
Yeah.
I really do.
Yeah.
I see more female saleswomen. Mm-hmm. I'm seeing more, obviously, because social media and marketing is kind of growing within the industry, you know, women are taking those positions and being more respected, too, because I can tell you in just the 2 years, it used to be like, oh, you do social media.
Yeah.
Now it's like, oh, she runs social media.
We got to talk
about it. There's a huge shift there.
Yeah, yeah. Well, at least they're recognizing it, you know, and sometimes, guys, it takes us forever to get out of our own way. You know, we get stuck in the mud. And we're all girl dads. So finding out how we can lean into
girl
that
mom.
Side of it. Yeah. How we can lean into that side of it, because I know my daughters can do anything and I want them to feel that way and know that way. And I want them to know a world that's that way. But
absolutely.
Sometimes it's not.
Yeah.
And so it's nice to hear that the boating industry is changing some and you're seeing more and more female presence in the boating.
Absolutely. Yeah. I give a lot of credit to my dad because although the way he grew up and in his era, you know, since I was a little kid, he always looked at me as just as equal to Joseph Galati III. Like there was no there was nothing separating us. Like there was nothing in his eyes.
That's great.
I could do anything. I could take over any business. I could CEO. And
that's
he just
awesome.
Always looked at me that way. And so that kind of, I think, gave me the confidence to be like, okay, I can understand these engine room specs. Okay, I can, you know, I can walk through this Viking 68 and, you know, sell it to this client and tell them everything they need to know. Like, nothing's intimidating because I was given that confidence from my family's values.
Yeah, sometimes I think not knowing something can be your superhero power.
Absolutely.
You know, I've been in, I remember I was talking to this builder one time and he said he was dealing with some folks that were on like a board or whatever. And I didn't say the F word. That was not the F bomb.
That was
a slip of tongue.
Not intentional.
That was
I don't think you
tongue.
Even said
I was,
it.
I was
so close.
I think it was some gin or rosemary in my teeth.
Definitely rosemary.
But he was talking to these boardroom guys, and they were throwing out all these alphabet sort of things to him and acronyms. And then he was like, I don't know what they're talking about. And I said, don't. You said, when I sit around smart people that have MBAs and all these degrees, you know, my number one saying is, hey, so listen, man, I'm just no garbage man. So I need you to break this down, because what people forget is 1 + 1 = 2, mm-hmm. right? But they'll make it sound like it doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Ask questions.
So
there's
ask questions,
no shame in it.
Right?
Yeah.
There's no shame in asking questions and getting through it, and that's really cool. Are you seeing some changes? Because it seems like the interior of boats are becoming a softer touch, especially in the class of like the 40, you know, the overnight sort of thing, the salons, the 44s, the 57s, the, you know, the 65s, you know, and on up. I'm seeing, you know, not, I wouldn't say so much in like a Viking, because I think you're geared to a fishing vessel that's also luxury.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in the motor yacht world, are you seeing a trend in like just softer touches? It seems like it's getting a different feel. They're not as harsh as they might have been with the,
yeah, maybe it's all the manufacturers realizing that it's the wife that makes the call. No, it's true, though. I mean, you know, if the wife likes it, then you're going to buy the boat. But no, I mean, you look around and you see all these houses going from that beige color to the white color. Boats are going to do the same. It's a much lighter, airier atmosphere that's desired now.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going with that trend, which I love, because I just think it feels so you know, luxury in a new era.
Sink line.
Open concept. Yes, you know, exactly.
I saw a Viking. It's probably on your video, but I saw a Viking the other day that had a farmhouse kitchen in it.
Yes, like that was my
video. That was your video. Of course it's your video. But it was like a fishing boat that had
It was an 80 Viking. It was so cool.
House, like a farmhouse.
And it was like a copper, like circle indented.
Like it was so cool.
Oh, it was awesome. I've never seen one. Those are the types of things that, like, when I told you about, like, people don't have a long attention span, so how do you take a walkthrough on a 3-minute boat that's going to take you that long to get through? Mm. And how do you shorten it down to their attention span of 7 seconds?
You hit that one thing.
That one thing. That farmhouse sink, that's going to make you kind of reach out and be like, okay, I want to see more of this boat. That's really cool, you know?
Oh, yeah. No, that was slick. When I saw that, I thought, wow, they've really upped their game.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I got to see that one.
You
know, I don't know if I've seen
the crazy thing on a boat is you can do anything you want to on a boat if you've got the money. You know, you can change anything out on it. You'll have to see it. It's her social media.
I don't know
if
Brandon saw this video, though.
What do we have here? Is this the drink?
This is the drink.
Oh, it's so good. Watch this drink thing, though.
I felt so bad, though, because
he missed the cup.
Yes, he did, and I should have made him reshoot. That's on me.
No.
They're just wiping up the wood. They moved the pad. Yeah. It's not his fault.
He's probably already had a couple, you know?
Everyone's like, okay.
You know what's beautiful about that is as a boater, as someone that's boated and you feel the waves and all that goes on, you know, controlling your big jugs of liquor, because I used to have them on different counters, and then I'd put them in a tub.
Oh, they rattle. Especially when you're on a Viking that goes top speed.
100%.
Yeah.
That underneath there secures all your liquor.
It really does.
I mean, that's, to me, just absolutely amazing.
Genius.
Man, that's
expensive. And I'd never seen that.
Is that made for boating, or is that something that they made?
I don't know. It's called Sidebar. I saw some comments, because that video did stimulate a lot of conversation, and people were like, oh, yeah, I've seen it on Rising Suns has it. Yeah. Some ocean yachts have it. So I did hear only boats, but then, it could probably branch out to more.
Well, I need to talk to them, because there's some people that I know that might like that. On the land.
On land. Can you put one under the poker table?
Under the poker table.
Just comes up and you just drink straight from
it. Our poker guys would love that. But, when I boated, the number one rule that I had when I was boating was to not find myself on qualified captain. That felt like the number one thing, right?
Aaron, he's another buddy of mine. Yeah. He's amazing. And it's funny because he really just kind of fell into that.
Really?
And now he just is like, I feel like he's almost
the
gossip girl of the yachting world, you know?
Yeah. Oh, and he's got, one of the things, which, by the way, is like a PSA, where he's talking about don't ride on the bow. You know, how many people that do bow riding?
We did a partnership with him, Galati Yacht Sales, I did a video about that. And we got so much hate. People really think, like, if they're not in the boating world, they just think, like, why wouldn't you ride on the bow?
Well,
and
because you can fall.
Because
you can get chopped up underneath it.
Yes.
It happens all the time here at Crab Island. Oh, just somebody in a pontoon.
It's horrendous. I know.
It's horrendous. So people out there, do not ride on the bow of your boats.
Don't.
Don't jump off a boat while it's running.
That's something I see happening all the time,
dangerous. It's dangerous.
You could get pulled up into those props.
Yes, 100%. Don't do it. The boat needs to be off. The props need to be turned off and not turning.
Yeah, I mean.
It just massacre you. It doesn't take but one second.
I bet every day at Crab Island somebody gets hurt doing something.
100%.
Boating is not supposed to be a dangerous sport. But if you add a little stupidity
to it, alcohol, you're there.
Well, and a lot of the times it's people that aren't experienced with doing the boat stuff. They come down and they rent one or whatever.
I never found myself in a qualified captain situation, fortunately. However, I feel like he could have an after show.
I've fallen off
a few docks myself. That's never fun.
It's like the worst.
I was down in the Exumas, and my kids had some they have these different you get to, I guess, trash, like sea trash, and they make these like ornaments or whatever, and you can hang them around the marina. And I remember trying to hang one up, and I don't know, I just looked up too long and I lost my balance, and man, I was in the water in 2 seconds. I didn't, and it was like I didn't even know where I was. Yeah.
It's gonna happen quickly.
I've had some of those after shows that I'm glad nobody was filming. Yeah, right? But yeah, I mean, it's been bad.
Yeah, I can't think of anything. I know I've done some stupid stuff, but
the only time I went in the water was after I caught my first blue marlin.
I saw
got
that.
Thrown in.
I saw
that. That was so cool.
That was your husband pushing you in,
yes,
by the way.
Yes, it was my husband pushing me in.
Where did you catch that? In Costa Rica?
Costa Rica.
I mean, that's like the top
the
place
number
to,
one place yeah, to fish. Los Sueños Resort, you go only a couple miles offshore. It's glass calm. And boom, you're on your first fish.
Episode 6, we had Brad Benton and Stan Blackman. I don't know if you know Brad and Stan. No. Brad was the boat captain to Emeril Lagasse, and Stan's... Okay. Stan's
was also he runs where, you where, never know
you or, never know
okay.
he's the captain.
Now
he's
very familiar with both those names
but they were on here and giving all kinds of fishing stories back then
he's on Never Settle Now. Yeah, I caught my first blue marlin last year in Los Sueños.
Amazing.
But they all said Costa Rica was there.
Yeah, it is.
Their on the Jane spot. Presley at Panama City Beach.
So cool.
Nice.
Thailand and yep.
Kept very nice. Tie. I haven't gotten my first blue marlin. I need to get
I
one.
Haven't got one.
We,
yet.
Caught, we went five for six.
Costa Rica,
I got a sailfish in Costa Rica.
We went five for six in one day. Five people caught their first blue marlin on the same day.
Holy
on
cow.
The same boat.
Oh, that's
was
what
it the
happened
same
to
blue
us.
Marlin?
Team Pilates.
Yeah. It's on, on YouTube. Yeah.
They say the cameras are unlucky on a boat. This is actually hilarious. And fishermen, they don't want to feel, they don't like no cameras. It's a bad luck thing.
It's about GPS.
And then I shoot a lifestyle video with a couple of my old sorority sisters that are also lifestyle influencers.
Right.
And we do a Costa Rica trip to showcase our inventory
very
there.
Cool. Nice.
So cool. Like, it was a really fun idea. We had a million videos we had to shoot.
Yeah.
Just like a content creation trip.
Okay.
And they've never been fishing. And we go out, Team Galati, and we all catch our very first blue marlin.
That's awesome.
Six. And
wow.
Six.
Wow.
Yeah. Six girls. And the that's funny thing
awesome.
Is like
you all caught a blue marlin.
Yes, for the
that's
first time.
Awesome.
That's why we all went in the water in that video.
That's wow. awesome.
But the funny thing is they were so not used to fishing, they were like, oh, that was fun. I'm like, wait, you don't understand. Like, that's a
you ruined
huge,
them.
I had to really, I'm like, you can't go fishing
first
again.
First time they ever went fishing and caught
a blue marlin. It's going to be as good as that.
People, like, literally go their whole life waiting for this moment, and you're like, if, you know, first hour on the boat, boom.
So to piggyback off of that, if you need somebody to help you film content, Marla.
I know I got any juice.
Yes. Yeah.
We know a guy. We know a guy at 850.
I already got some footage.
That's great.
You're listening to What the Hell Do I Know with JB. JB with ADHD. LMNOP. Anyway, back to the show.
So we are going to move on to play the game, Guess the Age. So I'm going to give you some celebrities. Right. The person that wins it will do. We'll do this cash register.
Can I play this one?
You're playing. You're playing. It's the closest one. The three of you are playing. Don't look at my sheet, Juice.
Oh, no.
But you're going to guess age. I'm going to give you the first name, the closest to it. So it can't be like, oh, he's like in his 80s or in his 20s or whatever.
It's got to be a number.
It's got to be an actual number, and it's the closest to it. All right, here we go. Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
49.
All right, 49 for Maria.
Shoot,
where are you going? Where are you going, Brandon?
Just guessing.
You gonna play the Price is Right and do like 48 or 50 or
something? I think he's 52.
I was going to say 54.
Holy cow. Brandon is like looking at my sheet. He is 52.
Oh, yes.
May birthday. We're like we're like twins.
Yeah.
Essentially.
Twinning.
Because I'm in May birthday.
I actually am a twin, so I know what that
you are
like.
A twin. Lady Gaga.
I guess he
should have given you your deal.
First. You go first?
Yeah, you go first. Lady Gaga, since you got it. Lady Gaga. Those at home, play along.
She's going to kill me. She doesn't know me. 42?
That's exactly 42. What I was going to guess.
All right, well, you can't guess 42,
okay.
Maria. You go one under, one over. You price it right.
43.
43. She's going over. Did you look at my sheet?
No.
She's 38.
No.
I'm sorry. Lady
Y'all are
Gaga.
Nailing
I can't
it.
See it. I'm trying to look, but I can't see it anyway.
Don't look. I'm gonna cover it up. All right. This will be a tough one because we'll see who all knows who this guy is. I think I've got two guys that'll know, but Maria, I want to see if you know who he is. Certainly you will. Jim Belushi.
Oh, yeah.
Is he still alive?
You don't know Jim Belushi.
I'm sorry.
He's got a cannabis
Brothers.
Show.
It
Blues
sounds
Brothers.
Really familiar, though.
Wasn't he the Blues
I wouldn't
Brothers
think so. I barely
Saturday
know him.
Yeah.
Is he alive?
He's alive.
He has a cannabis.
Okay, so 90.
Farm. That's what he does.
Yeah, okay. No, Juice has 90. Juice has 90. Maria?
88.
88. All right.
No, that guy is only maybe 69.
Oh, wow. 70.
You gave up.
70. All right. Tom,
he was just really
Tom Cruise. Certainly you know Tom Cruise.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, all right, Brandon, you're first.
Cruise is 56 with the Outsiders.
All right, 56. All right, Maria?
54.
Damn. All right.
That's what I was going to say.
Where are you going to
go? 57, I guess.
57. You're going to take it. He's had a lot of facial surgery. 61.
Wow. 61.
61 for Mr. Cruise.
Yeah.
61. He likes to be called Mr. Cruise. All right. Yeah. So here's another one for you, Maria. I'm throwing one your way, okay? Mr. Beast, otherwise known as James Donaldson,
yep.
The YouTuber extraordinaire. Mr. Beast, where do you think his age is? It's going to be Juice.
I don't know him.
Oh, you don't know Mr. Beast, a YouTuber. Massive YouTuber. Oh,
number one YouTuber.
Number one YouTuber for sure.
35?
35? Okay.
Yeah. I'd probably go his facial hair. He's probably 37.
28.
Oh, look at this. Maria's on the board.
Oh, I finally got one.
26.
20. Oh, wow.
And can you imagine? This guy is multi-millionaire. We're talking trending towards the hundreds of millions of dollars off of YouTube.
YouTube.
That's what Schultz is saying.
He bought like a whole street for like his friends and family, and he does these crazy stunts. You got to look him up, Mr. Beast.
He
builds wells in Africa, yeah.
100 million views.
He just did an obstacle course that he put on like cranes up high and had a guy run an obstacle course.
I bet you if I saw a video, I'd be like, oh,
you know him. You know him, yeah. Super nice guy, but he started like giving money away. So like he did videos where he's counting like how many pennies were in a jar or something. People watched it.
Yeah,
so it's crazy. But anyway, all right, last one. We'll do one more. Last one, Maria. You're going to go first. Mike Tyson.
67.
Okay.
Jeez.
Okay.
51.
51 for Mr. Juice?
56.
56. Brandon, I think you're going to win the thing. It's 57, which a 57-year-old should never be fighting, and he's got a fight coming up with
Logan Paul.
And I mean, 57, I'm 47, and my back hurts today, and I don't even know why. So, I mean, like, 57,
that left hook,
could
though,
you imagine?
That left
forget.
Hook.
If he, like, he can watch land out. A punch, for sure, if he that can left. Land a punch. But fighting a 26-year-old?
Oh, it's
like,
all it's, stage, it's don't you think?
Yeah, 100%.
It's completely 100%. I just have
maybe.
To believe it.
100%. I agree 100% with you.
Yeah, but Duke can still fight, though. They showed videos of him training. He can 100%. Still.
Oh, my gosh.
He's still fast.
I wouldn't do it.
By the way, we're going to give a shout-out to our show sponsor, Glotti Yachts. You can find them at glottiyachts.com. Our goal at Glotti Yachts, our goal is to provide you the very best boating experience, whether you're purchasing, selling, or servicing a boat, so you can enjoy a safe, comfortable, and exciting time on the water with friends and family. Absolutely. We're gonna put some videos up here so you can kind of see some B-roll going on around us and see some of what Maria is doing. And by the way, Maria, we'll throw up your Instagram because they should totally be following your social media.
Well, yeah, I was just saying, whenever we talk about that video of the bar, it's 172,000 views of that.
I just posted that yesterday.
172,000 views of
that
video.
Yeah, so that was yesterday. That company that does make that.
I tagged them.
Yeah. I mean,
we got to get a collab or something going on.
Yeah.
I've been having dreams, jumping on a trampoline, flipping in the air. I never land, just float there. As I'm looking up, suddenly the sky erupts. Flames and light the trees, spread to falling leaves.
You should be getting a call tomorrow.
We actually do get about 2 to 3 videos per month that hit over 1 million views.
Wow, that's amazing.
So, yeah,
that's
pretty
great.
Crazy.
That's,
yeah,
great.
That's great.
So we've got a quote of the day today by Tay-Tay. And she says, I'd be a fearless leader. I'd be an alpha type. That's I'd be a fearless leader. I'd be an alpha type when everyone believes you. What's that like? And that is from her song called The Man. Which, do you know that song?
Oh, yeah.
It's such a great song.
My daughters are huge Swifties.
Yes, and my daughters are. My daughters are, too. That's where this comes from, is my daughters.
You
got to
respect her hustle.
100%. I mean, she's the first artist. First artist, male, female, doesn't matter. First artist to hit $1 billion just by the music. No brand, no shoe sales or
collaboration. It's called inflation,
we're
though.
We're talking.
I mean, let's keep it real.
You can't give her anything. You can't give her.
Do you know how many people are obsessed with her? I don't doubt it for a second.
Yeah, for sure. Everybody loves her.
So, you know, when I was telling you the story about the Zoom, it was honestly a favorite trip. We left the boat down in the Bahamas for like a couple months, and we'd fly down there and get on the boat, and we'd just tool all the way down the Exumas and everything else. It was so much fun. And we were at Highborn Key one time. My favorite place in the world.
Highborn's
so great. We actually went to Compass Key and worked our way back up. So we went all, actually, really, I guess, Staniel Key, and then worked our way back up. And we were at Compass, and my wife and I were doing a little run or walk, really, just through the little trails into the kind of mountains, because it's this private island, essentially. And you can only get to, especially Compass Key, or really any of those, by boat. I mean, you've got some planes and smaller planes and things of that nature, but Compass is really, I think, by boat. And it's this one guy that owns it with like all of his kids, but he had kids from a lot of different ladies. So whenever he dies, he's going to have a problem on that.
Who gets the island?
Who gets the island? We'll see how that goes. But really, really super cool place to be in this world and hang out there. But we were just walking these trails, and all of a sudden this guy blows by us. And we get out of the boat, and it just kind of triggers. I'm like, I really feel like that was Lance Armstrong.
I remember that.
I really feel like that's Lance Armstrong. So a few days later, we're tooling on our way up, and we're at Highborn Key. And I know you've been to Highborn Key, and they've got this one dock that you can back up to when we were backed right up in this slip, right to where they have the little ring toss game.
Yeah.
And there's not much to do at the end of the night in these places. Yeah, so I was right in the middle of telling a story when, my favorite camera guy here,
It's about $3.50 podcast.
We're down to three. You said we were going there. You said we were going $3.50 today. But we're back up. We've got it all there. And this episode's so good, though. I think we're covering so much. But I was telling my Highborn story. So we get to Highborn Key. We back into the slip right where they have the ring toss game. And at Highborn, you don't have much going on. At Highborn, you go, there's like one restaurant there. But maybe a bar. I mean, it's like attached to the restaurant. I mean, but, essentially everybody goes back to the boats and you hang out. So the ring toss game is where everybody wants to come and play ring toss. And so I'm just sitting on the aft of my boat in the kind of the cockpit, and we're just having a few drinks, looking at the ring toss game, thinking about going to play ring toss. And next thing you know, up walks Lance Armstrong with like his son and some other guy that I think ended up producing his 20 for 20 or something like that, and walks up, and I'm like, that's Lance Armstrong. And nobody believed me. I said, I told you, I thought I ran by Lance Armstrong, or he ran by me, the other day, because he was still in amazing shape. And of course, I'm getting off the boat, and I'm going to play ring toss with Lance Armstrong.
Right.
He was... three sheets to the wind.
He didn't even know
his name. And the whole time he's playing ring toss, we introduce ourselves, and he says, well, I'm L.A. And I'm like, yeah, I know you are.
Lower Alabama?
What's funny is I finally told him, I said, man, I enjoyed watching you, win all those because I didn't want to go into the whole cheating deal and doping. They were all doing it. But yeah. I was like, I really enjoyed watching you win all those Tour de France all back in the day. And his buddy with him, he's like, well, at least you got one friend.
Wow. Oh, man.
So that was Lance. There's so many great adventures on the marina and at these docks when you're docked up there. Some you can share and some you can't.
Yep.
Because you see some of them. Lance probably won't appreciate that story.
Yeah, but can't reveal them all.
You can't reveal them all. But he was very generous. His son was very nice, and the guy with him was really nice. But you guys lean into family trips, right? I mean, you have all these meetups with boaters and what do you call them when you
get Galati rendezvous? My mom invented them back when she would. It's so funny to think about like how the circle of life, as my nan calls it, because my mom was a hardworking wife running the marketing team with the other sister-in-laws, mm-hmm. and she was strapping us down to the boat with car seats so that she could handle the lines.
Like, oh wow, that's
isn't
awesome!
So crazy,
that is so
like
crazy.
We were in a car seat in the aft cockpit, like with a belt around it tied to the bench seat so that she could go tie up the boat because it was just her and my dad. And they decided, you know, like, we got to give these customers, you know, something to put on the calendar. Right. So they remember, like, okay, we're going to use our boat because, you know, you got to get into it and you got to push yourself because it can be uncomfortable. And that's the other thing too, traveling with a group, traveling with people who've done it a lot before so that they can help you through any kind of like,
you learn all these tricks.
You do. You see and you all become these new more things. And more confident. Yep. And that's, so she started them and now we're still doing them to this day. You know, like I'm bringing my, it's a circle of life. I'm bringing my toddlers on the,
that's
on
so
the trip
awesome. Mm-hmm.
And we're going to Orange Beach next weekend. We do small ones like Port St. Joe, but then we do big company wide ones with like 20 to 30 boats in the Bahamas. The Keys.
That's right. That's right.
So, oh, that'd be awesome.
Oh, no, no.
So fun. It's
Eric's
really,
always trying to
I'll do
go
social
to
media content for that one.
100%.
Yeah, exactly.
They're great rendezvous and they take over when they do it. They take over these marinas.
Oh, I mean, yeah.
It's
like, no, the Port St. Joe one we did last year,
crazy.
It was the head of the house, the Chamber of Commerce, who came like from the city and was like, we're so happy you're here.
Of course he is.
Can I take a picture to post on the official Port St. Joe Instagram page? I was like, I'm
awesome.
So happy we're, you know, helping these.
You're like a traveling city.
Flotilla.
Flotilla.
Let me come and get all the food here. You know?
Yeah, for real. You're like, you see all that pull out.
100%.
The most people in the town at
kinda
once.
Like, yeah,
right?
Taylor Swift and her, how she boosted the economy.
You're exactly right. You're boosting one marine at a time.
Yeah. She's about to boost our economy. Is she building a house here or what, dude?
We don't know.
She's heard about the pod.
I just heard about
Taylor, Jerry Jones's neighbor.
Taylor, you know you have an open seat on our podcast. Just anytime, hit me up. Look, he won't even be here.
I'll miss out.
I'll be here. I got a ton of questions, Taylor.
Grown men that are Swifties. This is what you need
so
to flip for real right here.
Grown
men that are Swifties.
That are Swifties.
My husband has two daughters, and he is unashamed to say,
100%.
I love Taylor Swift.
Man, I'm all in. I'm a girl dad,
He's
man.
Like,
she's girl
do
power.
Do you see
I'm
her on stage for that many hours? Do you see her working
she
that
works hard.
Hard. Do you hear those lyrics that she wrote herself?
100%.
And you know what he loves too is like my daughters are looking up to her, this woman that's just kicking
working
butt
hard,
in the business and dominating. He's like, I love it. I love her.
That's great.
No
that's
shame.
Great.
No shame in my game.
So, and we were saying that you're a parent. You've got two young daughters. Do you recognize things you do that are the same as your parents, which you've talked about, like boating? But I mean, you know, just like little quips or things that, man, I just sound like my mom.
Yeah.
Do you recognize that?
Oh, for sure. Well, Italian heritage is really strong.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
I think just like the biggest thing that I was taught is just family is everything.
Sure.
And that just kind of goes through everything we do. Like I've realized I'm sitting in the car just with them today. Mm-hmm. Randomly, I'll bring up, hey, Harbor, their names are Harbor and Story. And I told them, I'm like, Harbor, do you realize that Story, who sit next to you, she's your best friend for your entire life? On your wedding day, she's going to be next to you.
Yeah.
She's going to be there for every big moment of your life. Did you know that?
Yeah.
And she's four and she goes, wow.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's funny.
Built-in best friend?
Built-in best friend. And that's how my mom and dad raised my brother and I. And he's my best friend in the world.
That.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was, you know, and I was kind of nervous to have two girls because like, the drama. I had a brother.
Oh,
I liked
coming.
That it was like.
It's coming.
Yeah. Right. It's coming. And I liked how chill it was just having a brother. We didn't have to like fight over clothes or like, you know, anything. And I was worried for them. And I said, no, what? It doesn't matter gender. You can raise your kids regardless of their gender and just teach them to respect each other and they're gonna love each other and fight less and love each other more, and that's all you got to do.
No, I'm you know, our kids were about 2 years apart each one, so two and two. My youngest of course is about four from the oldest, and but they all have these really unique relationships with each other, and it's, you know, I've said this before, sometimes I always feel like they relate to each other like I relate to them, but they don't. They have their own code language, their own words,
totally
how they, you know, and my youngest Sophia and my oldest Jackson have a different relationship than my middle and Jackson
and
have.
They know stuff so you don't know.
They do.
And you'll never know.
I know. They know. And they
forever.
Know, they know things that have happened in the home that maybe we haven't discussed about. And so but they know.
Mm-hmm.
And so they pick up on a lot of stuff for sure. Do you notice anything that maybe being of a generation, obviously, that's different? Do you know anything that you do differently? Are there things that you see differently in raising your kids that stick out?
No, because my parents were a little ahead of their time.
Do you think so? Yeah,
I do.
Yeah.
And because I hear about my friends and the way they were raised, and my parents just, they encourage us to be different. They wanted us to be outsiders and to grasp, like the things that made us different and quirky. Mm-hmm. Yep. And you know, like the little things my brother would do and what he wanted to wear to school, he really cared about his outfits. And instead of being like, no, I need you to wear this, like this, an image, you know, it was the opposite. It was, you do that.
That's cool.
Really did. And embrace, so I'm doing that too, because that is something that's more modern take, like be yourself, be different. And that's how I am with my two girls, is you guys are so different and I don't want to ever compare you to. Like, I don't ever want to say you act more like your sister, because I feel like that's where a lot of fights in the later years kind of bud from, this comparison game.
Yeah.
So I'm starting at an early age to make sure, like, they know they're two different people, and I will never once be like, I need you to act more like Harbor. I need you to act more like Story. They're two different people. Yeah. And my parents did that before their time.
Yeah. So
it's kind of different. Yeah. But no, they were perfect parents. I really.
That's great. That's great. It's,
I really have nothing to say that's different.
Well, they're really going to love this podcast.
They're going to love this
podcast. They're going to love this podcast. I will say one thing is,
Mom, I love you too.
Yeah, right? I love you, Mom. No, is maybe like more cautious about chemicals and foods, because maybe it's a little. We have more information. Yeah, yeah. So when I was like, you know, guzzling a bright red, you know, like Yoplait every single morning, like, that red dye 40, like, I'm not by all any means a crunchy mom or granola, as they say, at all. Like, I'm really not. But I'm just, we know more. Like,
we do know
more. Like, if my daughter has a Shirley Temple at dinner, she's going to go crazy for the next couple hours. And my parents didn't know that stuff.
I research everything now religiously.
Yeah, you're in it big time now.
8 month old. So,
see, I wanted to be healthier. I think there was a time period where we felt like we could also just afford like organic meats and things of that nature, but you know, in the beginning you're just kind of like,
it's just different,
you know, whatever it is. But yeah, there's a lot more information for sure.
Yeah,
No doubt. I mean, one of the things that does stay the same, I don't know that this is universal, but I think it may be, is my kids are allergic to throwing things away.
My kids have that allergy.
Brought up a huge one, actually. It's, I think, of a boomer millennial thing I notice is, you know, we saw our parents like attached to everything, keep every little Christmas, you know, birthday card, keep every little trinket, every little ticket souvenir. Stub. And millennials were made fun of for being so minimal. And it's almost like a hard reaction to, you know, our parents' like storage units being full of stuff. We're on the other side, like not holding on to anything. And they're like, why won't you keep this and that? And I'm like, I have a photo of it. I, you know, like, it stresses me out. Mm-hmm. I would rather not worry about
that's so funny, because I keep all these cards from all of my kids. I mean, this drawer for it. And I'm just like, what am I doing here?
I know.
I keep stuff still. I just, it's to a much more minimal degree. Like, my daughter comes home with artwork all the time.
Yep.
And I have to, like, you know, something doesn't, you know, speak to me, I'm going to hide the trash. But then I have this huge pile of things, like, I know she cared about so much. Yeah. Or I know she was really proud of. Those things stand out versus the just the project.
My third car garage right now is full of storage, because I finally cleared out a storage unit that I've been paying for almost 9 years.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, I could have bought several cars.
You're not alone in that. There's a lot.
But I think that's also just somewhat of American thing. I think it is a generational thing.
It's we hold
on to everything. It's like, we can't get rid of it. Yeah. And we're now getting rid of it, box at a time. But it's consumer culture. We are.
The trend I notice is each time of year, there's seasons in the house. So stuff changes in your house per season also. Yeah, so a lot of people have like additional furniture, but knickknacks.
Oh, you best believe I have my fall decor and my Christmas decor.
You almost need a decor room in houses now, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, one of the things that we try to do differently in our home is at least something that I really wanted to implement, is when I made a mistake as a father, I wanted to say I was sorry. I wanted to ask for forgiveness. I wanted my kids to see that vulnerability. And again, shout out to my dad, because I mean, I'm not, you know, I think that you just learn a little bit. And I think there was a vulnerability that I wanted my kids to say, hey, I'm not perfect, so I want to give you the chance to understand that I may have reacted in anger.
I may have done things. So I think I saw the same parenting video you did.
Probably.
And I do the same exact thing, because they need to know that we're not perfect.
Yeah. Sometimes you can react in anger. Sometimes you don't have the right answer.
I told my girls the other day, I have screwed you up. I don't know in how many ways, but I wasn't perfect as a parent.
Listen, I tell all my,
messed you up.
All my kids, they know their first like half dozen counseling sessions are on me. You know, and I'll go if they need me to.
Being a parent, it's not easy. Not
you guys have been wrong about stuff?
Believe it or not.
Man,
believe it or not.
A couple times.
Believe it or not.
Don't ever apologize.
But that's the generational thing, right? There was a time where parents didn't, you just didn't. You didn't want to show your
wrong.
You didn't want to admit
there was a level of respect that you didn't even second guess anything they said. Right. You know, now it's we have a lot more conversation, a lot more communication.
A lot more conversation. Yeah. The openness is something that's
absolutely
really unique in, I think, this next generation. Is something that I've tried to do with my kids, is just to be open and have a lot of little conversations about things before you even get to the big stuff.
Yep.
You know, so we you know, I can remember my son coming up to me, and this we're gonna keep it as PG as we can, but my son came up and we were shooting basketball. I was like 7 or 8 years old, and he's like, "Dad, hey, the guys at the playground, he went to Christian school, by the way, and they were like, they were talking about a blowjob, and what is that?" And I was like, "Well, let's have a conversation about that." You know? Yeah. I mean, so you have to have some of these really tough ones. Again, I'm not trying to be disgusting, I'm just talking about, you know,
everybody deals with that, I'm sure.
The conversation with kids, and you just have to, but the initial reaction is like, talk to your mom, or we're not going to talk about that, or don't say anything. And that may have been the old school way of doing it. But if you don't have those conversations, they're going to hear it from somebody else, and it's going to be inappropriate. It's going to be wrong.
Yep.
And it's not going to be what you want them to understand.
Well, nowadays it'd be a video.
Which is even worse. So for sure, you know, parents, if you're out there, don't be afraid to have the hard conversations. In fact, your reaction, what I would advise is, if you can not have a knee-jerk reaction to it, you know, the strongest times I've ever had is to be like, okay, you know, and pause for a second and then have the conversation.
That's always
how they get really weird when they start hitting like the 15, 16, 17-year-old world. And you're like, there are times Jags will walk in the room and tell us something, and we're like, well, you know, it's getting late. Let's just talk about it.
Let's sleep on this.
My initial reaction is, what in the hell?
Oh, man. Yeah.
It's like, well, let's just have a conversation. I don't want to, got to keep your game face on, you know? So it's really tough. So time off seems to mean a lot to this next generation, the millennial generation, even the generation coming right behind you.
Yeah.
Time off seems to mean, I mean, what would you say to folks in your generation or even younger that how to look at that? Because, you know, there's one, I think there's, you know, the old school guard is like, you know, you grind it out, you work until you die.
Yeah.
And you know, you don't take any vacations until, you know, you've hit the, something way out in the future. But, you know, that's not really how people are built as they're coming around.
Yeah. So I'm noticing my age and a little younger too are just, they're wanting to live in the moment, and they're realizing life is short when we, I don't know what it is or how that kind of happened, but they are, and they're just taking their, you know, every decision really it counts. And so my biggest advice is to find a career that you're passionate about so that it doesn't feel like you're miserable. Like if you are miserable in your job, life is too short.
It's too short.
Go find something else. Like figure out what makes you happy and switch careers.
Right.
Because you don't, that's kind of what I think the older generation, like if anything they taught us, it's that. It's, you know, you can have both.
You can have both.
And I feel like I'm so blessed to have found that.
Well, you can take a trip where you're doing
I know.
All your content creation.
I really don't have any days off. Social media doesn't sleep.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like real estate or sales in that way is like we can have a message in our inbox. It's like, I want to buy a yacht today. Like, and I got to get back to them in the middle of my vacation. So it doesn't really end. It's just a matter of finding that work-life balance. And I make sure I like allocate a certain time of my day that's fully to my kids, and then time of my day that's fully to work, so that they get, it's not just mommy and her phone all the time. That's something I'm trying to be super cautious of. It's so hard, especially when my job is my phone.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it seems like, oh, mommy's just on her phone. And it's like, no, I'm really hardcore working right now. So I just try to make sure, like, okay, how do I look in their perspective right now? From a 2 and a 4 year old, you know, I'm putting my phone down in this moment, and I'm not going to pick it up. But it's very hard. I'm not saying I've mastered
you're aware of it, because honestly, I say this all the time. I think the number one thing people can, if you can do something that's better about yourself, is having self-awareness, right? And just being aware that there might be blind spots that you have in your life, and how can I fix those? Because if you're aware of it, then you can fix it. But most people go through their life oblivious to having a problem. You know, I used to say it all the time when I'd speak that you would give a talk, and you'd I know that there was somebody in the crowd that would say, "Man, I know five people that need this," and you're like, "No, doofus, it's for you." And it's for me.
I feel that at church a lot. Yeah.
Yeah.
You look around and say,
"Yeah,
is that for me?"
I got to send them this video. Why don't you watch it?
Yeah,
for a second.
I've made the conscious effort around the baby to not be on my phone because
that's pretty good.
You see videos where they
sees it.
Yeah, it's an easy one. It's an easy one to do. Well, listen, let's jump into the Delve cards, which is our time for my buddy Juice.
Juice, oh Juice, where are you? We're waiting patiently for what you do. Google Guru, he'll make it right. In a flash, he'll solve the fight. Oh man, he's good at poker.
That's right.
What do you find fairly easy that others seem to struggle with?
Oof, what do I find?
I like to float up to people in the ocean and just talk to them.
And pee on. Get peed on, yeah. What do you find fairly easy that others
seem to struggle with? If you watch other podcasts, everybody will get that.
What's the question again?
What do you find fairly easy that others seem to struggle with?
Do we all answer?
Yeah, 100%.
Talking to strangers.
Yeah?
I like that, too.
I'm not good at that.
Going up to somebody and just... starting a conversation.
I love
what
it.
A weirdo.
I love it. I love it.
You know, I would say sometimes I think communication's probably on my skill set when I think about it. It's communication and putting together, a talk or a speech or something. Like
that. Mine's the opposite of that is being by myself. Oh, man.
That's really good.
These are good cards.
By the way, Delve cards are amazing cards. Parents, again, this is a great tip. Tip of the day. That's a great tip. Delve cards. Look them up online. Delve cards, D-E-L-V-E. The Delve deck. Get one. It is great to put on your dinner table at night. When your kids, you go to your kids, especially when they get older, and how's your day? And they say, well, I don't know. Okay, whatever. Pull out one of these cards. Ask a question. Talk about it. You'd be surprised at what happens. We do this in our family. We haven't done it as regular because I've left them here in the pod room forever, but I need to take them back downstairs.
Let's take them down there.
But they're such great conversation starters.
I'm walking away with great parenting advice.
They're really good. They're really good.
You should take these on the flight to Greece, dude. Yeah. You go through all of them.
Man, I'm going to be sleeping on the flight to Greece.
That is when you watch the movies.
I can't sleep on a plane. It sucks. When we're talking about the last pod, when we went to Fiji. I ain't sleep on
awake the whole time.
That's terrible. That's tough, man.
Oh, it's horrible.
Well, Maria, it was absolutely a blast having you here.
It really was. This
was just so great. You gave so many great, insightful things to your generation, my generation, the generations behind you. I hope you all got something from it. This is our section, though, where we like to say, listen up, kids. If you are part of that next generation, you have more value than you may realize. You see the world differently, and you should. You've experienced growing up in a different time, so of course you've had different experiences and you're going to see the world totally different. Expect pushback to your ideas, but don't let that discourage you. Use your determination, your consistency, and your hard work. Those are the things that are going to help make your ideas rise to the top. And listen, if you're like me and you're part of that old guard, man, you got to lean into the younger people. You've got to lean into them because they are our future. Find those diamonds in the rough and help them navigate that arena. I get it can be hard to remember when you were young, but this is part of our job in making the world a better place. Thanks again for listening. Like, comment, subscribe, or don't. What the hell do I know?
JB.
You've been listening to What the Hell Do I Know with JB. JB has worn quite a few hats. CEO, venture investor, accidental pastor of a downtown Atlanta church, board member, passive investor, and occasional public speaker. JB's passion with his show is sharing the good, the bad, and the downright absurd. Life's a mixture, right? JB has picked up some real gems along this journey. Lessons from the business world, the chaos of parenting, and the surprises of accidental leadership. We hope you've enjoyed the show. If you did, make sure to like, rate, and review. And we'll be back soon. But in the meantime, find Jason on Instagram at @_Jason_Becker. Y'all be cool, and we'll see you next time.